thank you very much. I'm going to be talking about not my current research, but more my hobby. Because, well, the other thing is if you look at what I've studied and you look at what the NSA does and you discount my civil libertarian leanings, you discount my horrible management skills, and you discount my refusal to get a security clearance, I'd make a great technical lead. Also during this talk, I will do a favor to anybody in government. There will be no top secret Snowden slides. So you don't have to worry about classified spillage. But my hobby is surveillance, understanding, building, countering, because it's fun. So first of all, the intelligence community has this concept called NOBUS, nobody but us. This is NOBUS, because nobody but us would spend $1 trillion on this flying brick when we're about to be overwhelmed by $1,000 drones. Surveillance tech is the exact opposite. It is hardly NOBUS. It's also not about finding needles in a haystack, because the problem is they have too many needles. If you have 5,000 known radicals in Paris, of which 4,990 are just people suffering from rectal cranial inversion syndrome, how do you know who are the two poison needles in the needle stack? It's also not about connecting the dots, because whenever something happens, afterwards, you have this. Yes, you had all the dots already, and you can make whatever constellation you want out of it. Really, it's about two processes, drift nets and pulling threats. So the idea on a drift net is you just cast your net wide over the entire internet, every flow you can get, on any sensor you can get, and the goal is to extract content-derived metadata. And some of it's just interesting, like this is a URL request. This is an iPhone. This is an onion URL. This is a PGP message signed by this person. To be honest, the spooks love PGP. It's really chatty, gives you a lot of metadata, gives you the entire communication record. PGP is the NSA's friend. Doc files. This is a document. This is who the author is. Now, if you want to find all documents written by Nicholas Weaver, you then have a very easy way of finding that. And then, of course, like, this is Mojahideen secrets. How many have heard of Mojahideen secrets? It's jihadi in crypto. It is even less usable than PGP. And because the brand is jihadi crypto, this tells you every jihadist on the planet. It's brilliant. Whoever at the NSA or GCHQ invented it, give them a big Christmas bonus. But the other part is the notion of pulling threats. You've gathered all this huge amount of information, and you want to follow it along to see where it leads. Because you start with some little piece of data, a URL visit, a name, a keyword, and you follow where that goes along. And this is very interesting because it means there's kind of this scale gap in these systems. They're really good once you have a single target and are following along. They're really good for casting drift nets over the entire internet and finding any record of this type. They really don't work well when you have your needle stack of 5,000 rectal cranial inversion cases. So let's actually put this in action. And this is a hypothetical case merged from actual cases. So some analyst is watching an IRC chat room, and Mr. Anon dude, they want to know who it is because he's a small script kitty suffering from rectal cranial inversion syndrome. And so all you know is that at this time, Anon dude visited this URL. It's not very much information, but thanks to the bulk surveillance systems you've built, you can find out who he is, and this, depending on your term, is either the digital network's intelligence flow or the signal's intelligence flow, and this allows you to identify who he is, get all his network traffic, get his pattern of life, know his taste in porn, and then step two is computer network exploitation. Basically, the flow is capture all, identify all, and once you find somebody you actually want to target, exploit by name. So it starts with your network of wiretaps. And if you're an intelligence agency, you have friends. Well, if you're a US intelligence agency, you have friends. And they've installed a series of wiretaps running software you've provided. And they're all over the planet. In fact, I made a mistake about the only place these taps aren't is on US soil. But how does an internet wiretap work? Well, it's just a network intrusion detection system. Network intrusion detection, bulk surveillance monitoring are the same thing. You have a tap on the wire, a high volume filter to ignore stuff, a load balancer, and then a bunch of processing nodes. And if you have multi-core systems, basically your multi-core systems are clusters of clusters. So a packet comes in. It gets examined by this high volume filter. Is this BitTorrent? If it's BitTorrent, we ignore it. So a few simple rules of all the crud you don't want to care about. BitTorrent, Netflix video, YouTube videos. Then you have the load balancer. And what the load balancer does is it looks at the packet headers, and it just hashes the source and destination IP. And everybody who builds a scalable network intrusion detection system does this because it's how you load balance. China does this for the Great Firewall. We do this when we're building NIDs for 100 gig links. And then that just routes to a processing node. And this is old known tech. This high volume filter and load balancer stuff these days, buy an open flow switch. Lawrence Berkeley National Labs is building a 100 gigabit bro system using an open flow switch to handle this load balancing high volume garbage reject. And once you have your load balancer, you have this linear scaling. You can scale up, throw 10 times the machines at it, you have 10 times the bandwidth. And 1U system gives you about 1 to 5 gigabits a second, depending on how good your code is. And you can also scale down. You can scale down to 100 megabit or 10 megabit by buying cheap little systems. So how do these systems work? Well, it's very conventional NITs. You reassemble the traffic, so all the packets are coming in pieces, and the pieces get put together into coherent flows. And now, once they're in coherent flows, then you parse the traffic. So you go, this is a web request, this is the URL, this is the host header, and all of that, and this is all your content-derived metadata. This is a URL request that has an identifier in it. This is a mail message with some guy to another guy. One thing that's important, these guys don't have to worry as much about evasion. So when we're building network intrusion detection systems, we worry about bad guys sending messages that the NIDs will interpret one way and the end system will interpret the other. These guys, the evasion is used for. So these guys actually have an easier problem. So if you want to build this yourself, well, I said NIDs are commodity. Download them. The one I like is the Bro Network Security Monitor. I use that in my demo. It includes protocol parsers. It's real-time operation. The disadvantage is it requires seeing both sides of traffic. So you aren't going to be able to put this on a network backbone. You can download Lockheed Martin's Vortex, which is a near real-time reassembly engine. So it takes the streams, turns them into files, and then when you receive the whole communication flow, it then invokes programs on it. It's GPL. You can download it from GitHub. And a outstanding bet that our friends in Fort Meade started their big systems based on this. You can always just write a check. There's this company called Nexa, used to be called Amesys. They sell commercial intelligence interception packets designed for network backbones. They call it Glint because it's global intelligence, and they advertise it right at the start. It looks at all the traffic. Now, when you're doing intelligence rather than intrusion detection, there is one real important difference. You care about people. So you've captured all. You want to identify them. So in this web page, well, you know who the username is. And if you look at the content on that site, you see, this is how the username is structured. this is how the cookies are structured, and so you just basically write an IDS rule that when you see this website, you grab the username, you grab the cookie, match them together, you know who it is. Likewise, all those anonymous tracking cookies for targeted advertisement, they don't call it targeting for no reason at all. You can de-anonymize those. So if we have a request, two separate requests with the same referrer from the same user at the same time for two different tracking domains and tracking cookies, now you can bind them together so that you can go from identify the user with the user tracking cookie, identify the common cookies. And then the other thing you do is bulk record. Santa, please give me one of these things. Network people love big amounts of disks. When in doubt, record it all, and then you just search through it. So if you need to search through something, there are tricks you can do to make it efficient, or you just grind through all the data. Hey, it's just data. Now, the key in building an intelligence system out of this is also adding federated search. So you're gathering this huge amount of information and shipping it back to HQ, for the most part, you don't want to do. Instead, you ship the query to the taps. So you do a single query, it runs on some or all of the taps, you have a setting of run on these allies taps and not those allies taps because we don't want this ally to know we're spying on them. And then the other thing is you do have some centralized data. So the bulk of the metadata is too big, but certain things like this is a page view for this user with this cookie from this IP at this time, that's useful data that you actually might want to keep around for months and search centrally. And so that's what Hadoop is for. And the easiest way to do this is create query-focused data sets. So you take this data into your central location, and you put it in buckets. So if you want to search by IP, you look in the IP bucket. If you look in the want username, you do it the username bucket. And you don't fully sort, you kind of quasi-sort, so these are basically hash buckets, because one of the little things on Hadoop is accessing one byte on disk is the same as accessing 64 megabytes, so why bother sorting too much? And so if you need to look up somebody's username, you know who the username is, you just look in that bucket and you know his history. You want to know who's been at that IP, you look in the IP bucket. And this is all easy. And this is how the magic works. So you start with that BBC page view. You query for the associated double-click ad. I love double-click. It's great. Then you look at that double-click cookie, and you query the database for the linked user IDs, because that's metadata that's small enough that you put back in your central repository. So now you know his Yahoo cookie, his this cookie, his that cookie. So all the cookies that are tracking, you know those. You also know who he is. Cool. Now you use those cookies to get the IP history. If he didn't log in from his VPN once and didn't clear his cookies all the time, well, now you know his home address. And now you toss that in your IP intelligence database. This is basically GeoIP on steroids. So all those lovely Android ads that broadcast your GPS location, well, those get thrown into a central database so they know what every address is. And this is the IP intelligence database. And now you know where his house is. And if he's in Syria, you drop a drone on him. If he's in Sweden, you do nothing. But in either case, let's say you want to take over his computer. Well, that's easy. And you can do this quite easily. So his computer does a web request. It passes another wiretap you have. And the wiretap sees, oh, this is for a bit of JavaScript, for a domain I understand, and a cookie that identifies this person as somebody I want to attack. And all I do is craft an injected packet and send it back. And as long as my packet arrives before his does, well, his computer starts running this. Super duper top secret stuff. It's called AirPwn without the goat C. This is the stuff used to pull pranks on Wi-Fi networks. You just remove the goat C, put it on the backbone, and hey, call it good. Or if you want to buy it, there's a company called Hacking Team that will sell this to you. They will charge $1 million for it because they're basically a defense contractor. And once the user's computer is now processing that injected packet, well, it then goes off and fetches this bit of JavaScript from your server. Now, your server goes, OK, who is it? In this request, you encode who I want to target and how aggressively I want to target. And you basically send back a bit of exploit. Again, some super duper top secret tool. It's called Metasploit. You can download it. OK, or you can pay Hacking Team or FinFisher a huge amount of money. And the big thing is the 0 days that you're using for the exploit. And well, there's a thriving market for that, too. Go out and buy it. Now, once his computer is exploited, he then goes and says, I want what the intelligence community calls an implant. And it's now kind of what the AV community starts to call an implant. But to be honest, all it is what we'd call a RAT, a remote access toolkit. You can download these for $50. You can download more expensive ones. You can buy them from, again, from Hacking Team and FinFisher. There's all sorts of vendors. If you're an intelligence agency, you can do them in-house. Although, to be honest, the best is probably the black market stuff because it's nicely deniable. Because, well, you just got owned by a rat. Was it the Chinese, the French, or some script kiddie in Germany? You don't know. And that's it. That's the entire basis of the flow. And I've ranted that it's easy, but, well, I built it myself. Unfortunately, my demo decided to eat its hard drive, so you get the canned version, which consists of an Intel NUC and a dual-com tap. Amazon Prime's a wonderful thing. It's even cheaper these days. UI is down. Really good for hotel wiring closets. This is the Mayflower Hotel in Washington, D.C. for a DHSPI meeting. I freaked out and locked the door, but the telco cabinet was open across from my room. So I provide a nice web interface. You can do a raw search. So search for anything with that article. Check to see that, oh, yes, this is the article. So this is the guy I'm looking for. So now at that IP, well, we know what the cookies are that are seen. And now we look at the double-click cookie. Double-click cookie is great because it gets the other address that he was active at and the associated Yahoo cookie. Now you know who he is. Now you know everything about him. That's easy. It's a very simple standard flow. And unfortunately, some disgruntled sysadmin told the rest of the world this is what how to do it. And then, well, you can task it. So tasking means, well, look for it and send an implant. And this is hobby level stuff. This is literally my hobby. OK, fairly extensive hobby, but it's hobby. So an important question, who are your friends? Well, if you're in the countries in blue, good news. All the countries in blue are your friends. And these are the intelligence agencies you don't have to worry about. I really like not having to worry about those guys in Fort Meade. They're my friends. If you're in the country in blue, however, on this one, well, this is the only intelligence agency you don't have to worry about, which is actually really good news because the French intelligence agency is really good and really notorious. If you're in, say, Russia or China, however, this is the countries in blue are the ones you don't have to worry about. So what do we need to do now? Go dark. We are in a world where if your adversary can see your traffic sufficient to identify you as a valid target, and this could be just your IP address, is you belong to the State Department, and your traffic is unencrypted, that is an attack vector, not an information leak. This is key. Unencrypted traffic is a vulnerability. Because in the end, what's the opposite of nobody but us? Undergraduate homework assignments. Questions?